Hello, malty meddling mounties, and thank you to Clayton Blaney for the malt mention. The malt mention for Whisky Review 628 here in the Manx Bothy, somewhere in the Irish Sea, with me, Ralphie, and a bottle of whisky. It kind of goes together, you know. It's a sort of a kind of a natural association. And the particular whisky today for this review is Glen Elgin 21-year-old Douglas Laing, old particular, single malt whisky, bottled at 51.5%, unchill filtered, natural colour, single cask. Why did I buy it? Why am I reviewing it? I'll come to that very shortly. Now, I've already poured a glass, as you can see. It's very gently opening itself up and creating some scotch mist. Look at that. Due to the fact that it hasn't been chill filtered and stripped of these lovely little oil particles that you get, not just from the cask, but importantly from the double pot distillation of malted barley liquor. What a lovely nose. There's a reason for this. The great thing about independent bottlings of any single malt Scotch whisky is not only generally do they bottle at a higher strength, unchill filtered, but importantly they give you some practical information which helps you to understand where the malt whisky is coming from, its provenance, its situation, its circumstance. And it's certainly the case here with this particular bottling. And if you can't get hold of this, no worries, malt mates. There'll be another one along before too long. That is the nature of single cask whisky. Once one single cask's gone, another single cask appears. Just the way it goes. This happens to be cask number, and I'll give you the reference in case you find it in your travels. DL10185. That is the cask reference for this. It is one of 219 bottles. But what's interesting is when you read further down, it says charged from a second fill sherry butt. Now, butts, sherry butts, are big casks. They do not usually contain only 219 bottles. What's going on here? Why only 219 bottles out of a large sherry butt whose original capacity was certainly over 450 litres, possibly nearer 600, 650 litres? Quite simply, what are the options? Has the producer had problems with the cask leaking and, you know, a lot of losses through Angel's Share? I doubt that. You see, the thing about sherry butts is they're big vessels. They need to be strong to contain, hold and secure the volume of liquor that they are maturing. And as such, they tend to have proportionally less Angel's Share. One good reason for this is the fact that the surface to volume ratio of liquor to cask is less in a large cask than it is in a small cask. Therefore, the proportional losses through evaporation are less. There you go. That's one theory. Another reason, a practical reason, is that although it's a single cask bottling, there's been several bottlings taken out the single cask. In other words, this big cask has not been bottled all at once. Half of it could have been bottled 2 years ago, and the other half has been bottled now. And this is to do with supply and demand, with the independent bottlers basically tailoring the releases that they offer in relation to the expectations for demand and sales of particular names. So, for example, if it was a cask of Lafroy they would bottle, they were bottling, they'd bottle it all at once because they know the name Lafroy is going to sell out their bottlings pretty darn quick. However, if it happens to be a bottling of Altmore or Caperdonnock, they know that these are not well-known names, there's going to be less demand, and therefore they need to make less available to sell their batch. And possibly that's what's happened here. So there's a number of reasons. But interestingly, it starts to give me a handle on what to expect out of this smell and taste experience. I expect, because I know for a fact, that it's going to be Glen Elgin. What is Glen Elgin? It's a big, fat, sweet, malty style of Speyside single malt, rather like Glen Grant, good example, or to a certain extent, Craganmore, another reasonable example, or Cardew, great example. Malty malts. Glen Elgin, we generally see as a 12-year-old single malt official bottling. That's what you come across. It's decent. It's a perfectly acceptable, palatable, slightly over-processed single malt. You know, that colourant thing and that chill filtration thing, unfortunately. But as an independent bottling, Glen Elgin tends to show well. Certainly within the Douglas Laing range of Old Particular, you get some pretty good bottlings. I can think of at least one where the general consensus out there is that it's not so good, but however, that's just a limited opinion. Glen Elgin appears amongst many independent bottlers, namely Gordon MacPhail, where it kind of varies a bit, but Signatory, I've noticed that Signatory do have consistent good quality releases of Glen Elgin in their range of single malts. So you're really getting a good show from Glen Elgin. As an official bottling, you have some 14 or 16 year old, which you may find in some of the dustier shelves of shops. And if you come across either the 1971 edition or the centenary edition of Glen Elgin, they are damn good single malts and well worth drinking. Believe me, malt mates, I've been there and I've had the pleasure. Shall we continue the association? Of course we will. Here it is. Smell. Let's start with that. Malty. Big and malty. And then I notice behind that big, rich maltiness, that sweet nose, it is a sweet nose, a really good cask. Why? The clues in the label. This is 21-year-old Glen Elgin, matured for 21 years in an ex-sherry butt. That butt was filled with this liquor in 1992. It's a second fill of this sherry butt. It says so on the label. More useful, practical information, malt mates. And what that tells me is that prior to 1992, it was filled probably for at least 10 to 12 years with previous single malt whiskey in its first fill, which takes the cask back to 1982 or 1980. Now, at that point, the sherry cask, the sherry butt, would have been maturing sherry in Jerez in Spain in the 1970s. In the 1970s, sherry was fashionable. It was a popular drink. A little tipple of sherry, very much in the British calendar. And as such, you're really looking at an age, a generation where good casks were being used for full maturation of sherry with wood which was sourced locally and hand-coopered and not kiln-matured, but air-conditioned in a traditional way. So I'm really getting an awareness now that this 1970s sherry cask was a good'un. And it's showing in the nose already. big, rich, sweet, raisiny, mentally spicy arrival, delicious, distinctly sherry tinged. What kind of sherry? Hard to tell, really, because it's subdued, but it's not too discreet. It's asserting itself in harmony with the spirit, because this Glen Elgin, having had a gentle experience with the cask being maturing this spirit for the second time round in its use and its history in Scotch whisky, it's already been maturing a single malt for about 10 to 12 years, probably, and as such, a lot of the assertiveness and the aggressiveness of this big sherry butt would have been toned down, so that when it comes to a second fill with whisky, with new mixed spirit, the interaction is more prolonged and gentle. Now we can see it's prolonged, it's 21 years prolonged, and it's gentle, it's sympathetic. The cask is not dominating the experience, and it's giving you such a lovely, refreshing, yesteryear flavour of a single malt whisky, a style of single malt whisky, which we're seeing less of now. It's like a decent old school Glen Grant. It's like a Macallan we used to remember with affection. That's the sort of characters coming through here, with this rich, full-on, assertive, malty malt, with its appley notes, citrus, slightly fruity, plenty of raisin, sultana complex, and then the spices, the menthol, the little bit of herbal in the background, just building up this full-bodied delivery of flavour. Assisted and ably helped by the fact that it was bottled at cask strength and unchill filtered, natural colour. It's the perfect storm for a malt moment, malt mates. It really is. I took a bit of a punt in this. I said to myself, Glen Elgins from independent bottlers are generally good. Let's do a bit of online research and take the risk. Let's risk it for the malty biscuit. So I did. And it was a risk worth taking, because the result is a very satisfying, characterful, good quality, well-matured, traditional single malt whisky. And at 21 years of age, to buy this in Britain is not too expensive. It compares very favourably with official bottlings at that age, bottled at that age. It's delightful. Lovely, fresh, rich arrival. Slightly spirit-driven. So you're getting fresh fruit notes, but you're also getting an assertiveness over the development of a fine old quality sherry cask with its leather, tobacco, and a little bit of polish, a little bit of beeswax polish in there. Some burnt complexity is provided by some burnt marzipan, a little bit of nuttiness, and altogether, it's just a joy. 90 out of 100. If you like that malt mark, because that's what it is, malt mark, I highly recommend, malt mates, that you go and cross-reference between Whiskey Fun, Malt Maniacs, and Whiskey Base, these now established points of reference, and just get a feel of what is available and what people think of the full spectral range of Glen Elgins. Not just the official bottlings, but the independent bottlings, and then match what you find up with what's available where you are. Now, it may be the official bottlings are all that is available where you are. Great, the official bottling's decent, I've reviewed it twice, and both times I was very happy with it. It's a good substantial single malt, which benefits from the fact that there's not too much demand for it. Glen Elgin is not a name of a distillery that trips off the tongue. It's not Talisker, Lagavulin, Macallan, Glenfarclas. It's not got a big profile. As a result of which, the proportion of better quality casks in storage is possibly higher. The amount of effort that the producers have to put into the brand to sell their brand, because it's not a name that sells itself, is such that you have more continuity of good quality bottlings. I'll leave that with you. I will conclude now with a little bit about my malt mark. Where does the malt mark come from? Well, 90 out of 100 denotes the satisfaction I've had with this bottle purely on smell and taste. Nosing and sipping here in the Manx Bothy. If I was to have a dram of this in a bar, you may have someone next to me who was a bit smelly or was wearing too much perfume. We may have distractions in the conversation. Perhaps there may be background smells which distract me from this dram. Perhaps there may be something in the water. It's chlorinated water. The jug that the water's in has a residue of detergent. These things can happen in bars. And therefore I would get a different experience. Perhaps the conversation that I was having with friends, acquaintances and malt mates might be distracting me, positively or negatively, from the experience of this whiskey. Therefore, this malt mark is based on me buying a bottle, bringing it to the Manx Bothy, opening it, letting it breathe, letting it sit about for a couple of weeks, having a good few drams before I actually settle down to review it. And then the result is based purely on the combination of objective and emotional interaction with the smell and taste of that single malt. And that's the only way I can do it. It would be tempting, would it not, to go and see what other people have rated it and then slightly just adjust my marks, my malt marks, to be compatible so as to be acceptable and not to veer away from the norm and the general trendings. But that's not the way I choose to do it. My malt marks are purely as I find the experience here and now, as I'm sharing it with you. It's the only way to do it. You will find they can be fairly closely grouped, but there again, I don't review anything below 80 out of 100, and I rarely review anything that's going to score more than 93 or 94 out of 100. That's just the way it is, and that is why the malt marks are just a simple point of reference. That is all. They are not the template on which you decide whether what you are going to or not going to buy. Cross-reference. Get the bigger picture and then narrow it down. I'm Ralfy, here to help. Happy to be helping. Helping with the malt moments. Malt moments are concluded. Thank you. Please subscribe if you haven't. Thank you, Patreon pals, for being Patreon pals. And thank you for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this malt moment. This malt moment is done. Bye-bye.